side, our problem is this, and we will focus that on the UI part of it. So, what we provide, I'm part of the FDL agency and the production office of Sofia. I've been a web developer for 12 plus years. I am very enthusiastic about any type of performance, whether it's backend or frontend, because in the end, our clients and our customers expect fast websites. It doesn't matter whether the server is fast or the frontend is fast, both of them should be fast websites and fast website. So, this is a very important topic for me. I've been helping and being part of the Go community for the last bit more than 6 years. I've accumulated some patches and helped around. You've probably seen the JSON API introduced lately. So that's pretty much all for me, and let's get on with the session. So, website performance. We have a server and a client, that's a given. So to make our system fast, we have fast execution on the server side that delivers us a page, and then an efficient way for whatever the server has given us to essentially display on the client side. Server, it does pretty much gets request, one of the many types of requests, generates depending on what your website is going to do, a particular response, it could be a heavy one, an easy one, and so on. Ideally, this is a complicated topic, and there are many sessions that can cover how to optimize server performance through profiling, stress testing, and setting on server level or tuning of servers and so on. But essentially, we generate a response and send it out to the client side. For Drupal, as it's a properly heavy system, most commonly we have cache after we have generated the response. So there is where page cache comes into play, or other HTTP caches like Varnish or, for even better, CDN servers that actually cache the whole HTTP request and response that was generated for the client. And from that perspective, our server overhead in the, let's say, best case scenario is very close to zero. But even then, there are cases where even though your cache or page is fully cached, there are cases that I've seen in practice where everything is cached, everything is served from somewhere, and in the end, the website is still visibly slow. And this is primarily on the second part of the website UI performance, that is the client side. So the client is responsible to request data from the server, receive it through a wire that is in no way something that we can control. To some extent we can, but not fully. When they fetch everything they need and they render the page. So this is all the stuff that clients are responsible to do on a per request basis. So once you do the request, you fetch whatever you need to fetch. You need to analyze it, and this is what browsers are doing, because HTTP as a protocol is a text-based, it's not physical in any way. So we fetch the data from the server, then we parse it, analyze it on the browser level, see whether it's a valid one or not, and whatever we have or browser can parse, then be displayed. During the analyzation phase, all browsers, they are deciding whether or not there are so-called critical resources on the page, and they fetch primarily that, and until they are fetched, end users are seeing essentially a blank page. So in that case, this is why they are called critical resources, mainly because we need to be mindful about them before covering a bit what precisely they are and how to mitigate the amount we need for them on the page. And once they are fetched as well from the network, and they again need to be parsed and analyzed on the client side. And then after everything is present, the browser page, and you will see something on their screen. So this is roughly what, on a very high level, browser does on every click that our users do. They send a request, parse whatever they get, and if it's an HTML one, there's like info resources, they fetch them as well, parse them, and do anything. We'll cover each of these steps in some more detail. And I know this is titled as a front end session. It affects front end, but there might be some networking and terminology involved that is not purely front end. I excuse you for that. So let's go into details. The thing is, if we have a new customer on our portal or website, he's coming to the site for the first time, then essentially has never accessed our servers, he doesn't have SSL connection and so on. So in the current present state of internet, we're using TCP/IP as a protocol for internet communication. And based on the TCP connection that is established between the browser and the server, we have the HTTP protocol that is responsible for the data and the essential information for the page to travel between the systems. So the thing is, our clients are highly affected of first these initial connection times and then parameters of these networking connections. Lately, Google is highly ranking sites that are secure, I mean have encryption on the connection, meaning HTTPS, TLS connections, and on this level they have additional overhead, at least initially. Properly, and they have the needed caches and configurations on the server side, this is highly reduced. But initially, we need a couple of so called round trip times, this metric here on the third point, to actually establish the connection and be able to send the request help. So, the second thing is so throughput and round trip time, they are somewhat related. We won't go much into details, but round trip time is essentially the time that the client sends a minimum set of information and then goes to the server and back. So this is the round trip for communication for any type of data to go the whole trip from client to the server and back. So the problem here is that it doesn't matter is your server, in the end, you cannot be faster than the round trip time from client to server. And as we're making bigger and more nice projects that are globally targeting the whole earth, let's say, these round trip times are essentially just growing the further you get from the origin server. This is where CDNs come into play and stuff like that, because they try to reduce this round trip time overhead. Throughput is another metric of the connection that you can imagine it as a pipe. You might have a very small pipe that can have very small amounts of data both through it, and a high throughput connection can target a lot of data through it. So that's pretty much how it is. And the two things are highly connected, the round trip time and the throughput, because this thing starts always with a small amount of data, and on each round trip, it's more and more and more. So this is the so-called slow start, and you can further check its network detail on this level. So I don't go into details for this one. But the issue is that even if you have a fast throughput connection, there is time until it ramps up to actually be able to serve that bandwidth, because all connections usually start in a very slow state. So we'll see what can be done on this. So for initial use size, they are on Unix level and on any operation system level configurations that can set how big the window size is initially on the image. So you can then transfer more data initially. And having a CDN or anything like this can reduce the round trip times,
at that point.
The next step for browsers, they have sent, received the data, and they need to parse it. So depending on what request we have done, different things are parsed in a different way and have different overheads on the browsers. So HTML is parsed as node as HTML, they build a node tree of the browsers. At that point, they fetch the critical resources, and these are JavaScript and CSS, located in concrete places on the HTML document. So for CSS, they are, again, tree-based structures. So they again build another tree, and then you have these two data structures that whenever browsers are engaging manually, they need both of them, because one represents the structure of the page, and the other one represents how the structure should be visualized for the users. So once browser has both of them, they can start rendering and show anything different than a white blank page. If we have JavaScript located in the header section, this makes it a critical resource, because browsers are not doing any rendering unless everything that is a locally defined resource in the header is fully downloaded. So in that case, all CSS and all JavaScript defined in there should be downloaded, parsed, and executed before any rendering happens. On top of that, before our clients can read a name on the website as well, if we have custom non-supported fonts, not natively supported by the operation system or browser fonts, at that point we might have issues. Because there are these cases of flash of unstyled text, and unstyled text or missing text at all, because you see a layout and everything else, but no fonts. So we'll cover in detail other things. So we've already mentioned that precisely critical resources are so-called resources that block render on browser level. This was very common in Drupal 7 world, where by default Drupal was adding everything to the header section, namely CSS and JavaScript. And the more bigger project you get by default, the smaller it got every time. On the contrary, for Drupal 8, this is highly revised, so everything is by default added, at least JavaScript-wise, to the footer, so it's a bit faster if not blocking the rendering section to that bigger extent. Still, Drupal settings are on the header. CSS are still in the header, and in a blocking way, so the bigger your design website gets, it will start to decay, at least if you're using just core. So, in the end, UI performance, once we have all of these things covered, boils down to how fast can we fetch stuff through the network to our browsers or to our clients' browsers, and then how fast we make the browsers render, parse, and display these things to our users. And last but not least, as any performance-oriented thing, the less things we need to do, the faster we do that things. So it's very important that we reduce the amount of data that we need to transfer to the wire and stuff that we need to send out to the browsers. So here I want to introduce this term called performance budget. In very short, it's, you can imagine, as a very standard budget. I have a wallet with some amount of money, that's my budget. So if I want to, let's say, buy a house, it depends on my budget. I have the budget for a house, I'll buy a house. If I don't, well, I have a problem. I'll need to do something. It's either going to be a small house, a small one that I can afford with my budget, or I need to gain something. I need to increase my budget. So pretty much that's the idea. We can, let's say, have separate budgets for each of the subsystems on our performance portfolio. So maybe budget for network, our clients can collaborate that amount of round-trip times per connection, or we're targeting that amount of round-trip time level of speed, and this is what we can guarantee. Because you can't guarantee any type of performance to anyone if you can vary round-trip times throughput on a connection and so on. I'm not going to cover packet losses on private networks because it happens and here in Europe things are getting better. From what I've heard in Africa and somewhere in Asia, it gets a bit more broken, so you start losing packets, this gets more delays on top of everything. But again, the idea for performance management is that it can give you a framework that you can track what you need to do, when you need to do it, and pretty much how. Because everything that you need to optimize usually is reflecting on other topics. So for example, if you want to improve time for rendering and whatever, you might stress networking more or CPU more, or whatever resource you might be having a limit. The main and the most common limits on UI performance for browsers are these four. You can always add more in different ones. But for standard HTML-based websites, these are the most common three. So you have networking, how much limits you can achieve. Very commonly, whenever you have limitations and targeting anything that is related to mobile apps and mobile devices, you need to target page sizes of about 1 to 2 megabytes as a version, because otherwise, on slow internet connections, you just don't have the time to download them for reasonable time frame. And again, this should be with the given parameters, for example, so throughput and round trip time, for example. With a connection of 0.5 megabytes per second and round trip time of whatever milliseconds, we need to cover that amount of time and things like that. And the main things that we need to optimize, we can optimize, are the components that make up the page. So the page can be either the main document, it could be a huge HTML one or a small one. The CSS we style the document with, JavaScript we execute, images we show, fonts, and many other things that can be shown on a page. Because it was one thing 10 years ago when I started the internet, it was much simpler than it's currently. So here you can start thinking of complicated external documents, embedded iframes with mobile apps or web apps. Anything in between might be used and I don't know what else. So it's a scary space internet and many things that can go slow. So the document cover the main ones that are most common and everything else kind of boils down to what is this. And the only things that we can optimize are first how fast we push the data to the network and during the user time. What are we pushing to the network? And then there are many cases where if we can do or we have done everything that we can on the first two topics, at that point we start thinking. This is in the motion that we're not doing changes. The idea is that we want to improve perceived performance. Because at that point, you know that you can't make faster, there are some physical limits involved. So at that point, your idea is to actually make it seem it works fast, but it's slow. So, for example, these are Drupal 8, big pipeline, and things like that. You give 95% of the page very fast, but it's not a whole page. But then you give the last 5% and it's slow. This is essentially the same. So, there are many techniques that can go into that direction once we have exhausted all our one-on-one ways to optimize the page. So, these are First, on the production. So it's one thing for you to deliver a page that is half a megabyte of size and one that is 100 kilobytes or whatever. Big one or small one, it really depends. There are many ways to reduce the set of elements there. There are stripping of additional elements, stripping of white spaces where possible. Polluting the HTML will generate, dropping elements in there if they're not needed by the UI implementing it. So another very important thing that helps on delivery time, so it's the compression. By default, it depends on your server setup and how you're going to do it. So you need to be sure that HTML documents are compressed because HTML as a format is highly compressible because it is text based. So if you have a 100 kilobyte word of HTML page, must compress it like 10 to 15 kilobytes. It really depends on the data you're pushing through, but it's most commonly highly compressible. And you can get much bigger speed increases with very simple configurations on server level, but with always the compression and things like that. The next bit is we can speed up stuff if we don't need to generate it from scratch every time. This is where cache comes into play. And for our fortunate luck, Drupal is very efficient into doing any type of caches. So in that case, pretty much any Drupal website is simply covered in that aspect. Drupal has a very creamy cache system. It caches within. So we are more having issues of not caching anything, but deleting whatever we have cached. But websites running Drupal are usually fast and not lacking this particular type of optimization. And the next thing that we can optimize is actually having a CDN, because if our servers are in America and we certainly somewhere in Europe, the round trip time for the Atlantic Ocean or wherever the ocean is there, it's slow to half second. So you have round trip costs. Even now, how small or easy your website is done, there's half a second of the edges. So this is where CDNs come into play. They have these scattered servers all around the globe, and once a server is formed, so it has cached your data, then you are not reaching to the origin server, you are reaching to the closest edge server and downloading everything from there. This is greatly reducing round trip times and offloading the servers that actually serve the website. So it has these two helping each other directions of speeding on the website. First, you can handle more traffic with the same servers, and second, the traffic that is served through the CDN is much faster for your end users. Another thing, optimizing the document is doing, let's say, partial document. This is pretty much what impacts us on an automatic level, but there are many ways to don't have Drupal 8 for a similar system, then you can have layer loading of data. So you can load the whole page and then load the things that are heavy a bit later. So users can see a page, start interacting with it, and see some loading bar or whatever, and then load the rest as needed. I've already mentioned it a couple of times. By module does precisely this type of optimization, transparent for any authenticated Drupal user. So our next resource, this is the CSS, and this is, as we mentioned already, a critical piece of our websites, because without it, it's either very ugly or they don't see anything. So what we can do first is have some kind of preprocessor, first because it will ease development and for overall maintenance, so these are some sort of paths, and have a file per component or component creation. So the important thing was absent, because yet on all our pages, we get all the CSS for publishing, or the whole CSS tree every time it needs to apply this huge tree every time to every page. So the bigger this is, the slower it gets, purely for browsers to do their work. So final per component in Drupal 8, this is done through the libraries APIs, and the idea is that if you do a new custom block and you create a new whatever file is for that block only, do the block only, and once you place that block on the one page, only then the CSS is added to the particular page. This is essentially how introducing the so-called unused rules on the style sheets. There are tools that allow automation of that process, but they have their caveats as well. So if you have single-page applications that don't have any content in them, I had cases where I received a pre-done design on my website, and it had like a megabyte worth of CSS for a single-page application. It was clearly something broken, but just half an hour later, passed into some tools, we go like 10 kilobytes of CSS. This is something that can be done very fast and very efficient. But the end result was that this page was physically faster. Another way to, at that point, start faking performance is the so-called process of inlining the critical CSS. So there is, first, CSS is a critical resource, so browser does not make any rendering unless you have it. And then there is the critical CSS that is needed to show the piece of the screen that the users will see once they enter the page. So the process of generating this critical CSS, there are tools for that. It's, let's say, automatable, but not easy at that point. The idea is that you show this CSS in Lightroom waiting for you to download the network, so it's very fast and efficient, and it's very small. At that point, all the other CSS is added to the page asynchronously to JavaScript. So clients can start to render this information pretty much whenever they receive the HTML. So there are no additional round trips to the critical path. Greatly increasing time to first render. This is another metric of the performance, so how fast users will essentially be able to see something. Because I've seen some worst cases like opening page, staring at the black screen on mobile device for 30 seconds. It's never a pleasant experience. And there is again the aggregation. For us, Drupal is doing this one pretty much for free. There is this nice checkbox on the performance page, aggregate CSS. There is the same one for JavaScript. There is a small caveat that for HTTP1, this is the old version of the protocol that we use for the web, aggregation is higher than it because it helps tremendously scale the whole process of delivery. Because single request is ahead. Currently, all CDNs and many of the servers that they already have encrypted connections are supporting HTTP2, and this is another version, major version of the protocol that actually runs the internet, and it is helping to download items first concurrently and much more faster, and it is the recommended protocol to have our servers configured on. So, what is the so, for HTTP1 aggregation is recommended, for HTTP it is, let's say, not that recommended. So you need to have some, but not that much, and you might not have any, because it's much more efficient serving many small files. And you can cache them per file, more efficient in aggregation, and so on. it, we can identify it, we can make it smaller, we can compress formal formats. The difference is that JavaScript could not, might not be a critical and blocking resource. It could look at the image at the end of the page or all the basic content. The only main problem with JavaScript is that essentially it is a programming language. CSS is a declarative language that browsers can parse and apply directly, where JavaScript, for better or worse, is a dynamic language that we can express our knowledge and ideas with. The problem with that is that not all algorithms write are efficient and fast, and they sometimes depend on the page size, elements, start count, and so on. So it's highly important if you want to have a performing website. Once we have, let's say, a working feature in JavaScript, to validate will it scale if we start having thousands of elements and things to trigger on, or, yeah, that's pretty much idea, because if we have a lot of JavaScript, then browsers are having struggles parsing and doing a lot of these scripts. And the same for things. So, next big topic for UI is images. I haven't seen sites without images, and they're the most common source of anything between 50 to 99% of the page size. It really depends on what website you're doing, but most common than not, the bottleneck on downloading resources on the page are images. In that regard, Drupal helps us tremendously by first having image styles present in the system for free, so we can just, whenever we show an image, we define the image style, we use the image style, and never the original, precisely for this one. So the smaller the image we can transfer, the faster it will go to the browser, the faster the browser will show. The other option that we can work on images is not just resolution, but the quality. So it's one thing to show original image, and it's completely different beast to show compressed JPEG.
Just configuration.
might serve millions of pages, and you can just build any browser, any connection, any internet plan if you download all of them. And this is where it is loading into pages. It doesn't load them unless you want to see them. So the moment the user scrolls down, you see new images and so on, but they're loaded as he needs them. It is a very simple process. There are many modules for this endpoint. There are many libraries that do this on our main custom implementation, and this helps tremendously. There is this write section. It works precisely as the aggregate. I find that it's HTML from hot only because for HTTP connections in Europe, this will cause more harm than help. And last but not least, there's sometimes that you just can't make it seem faster. For example, you have this huge Euro banner image or these thousands of small icon images, and you can't serve them in a native way. So at that point, we either put a placeholder that will say, download an image, wait a bit more, it will show up. Or you show a small map and sketch it, so people see a very degraded quality of an image, but then something. And then once the huge image goes, you see the whole thing. It causes some essential overhead because you're serving two images instead of one, but the perceived performance of the page is easily different. And the last one that is very depending on the situation, you might actually inline images directly in the document. This is often used when there are small SVG type of images that are used for icons throughout the page. Sometimes they get compressed very efficiently as they are part of HTML. Fonts, my favorite topic. Every designer likes them. Custom fonts are awesome. You can do pretty much whatever you like with them and have strange images on your website. But for better or worse, I've seen websites having megabytes worth of custom fonts on them. And it's never a nice experience actually working with these micro websites. So my recommendation is first consider using standard fonts. So if you can use Arial or a designer, I really don't care. But this will first allow users to see the text in your pages insanely fast, like zero round trips. You can't get faster than that. And it will work on pretty much any system out there. It doesn't matter the rendering, you have all the symbols installed. Having said that, I know that the world is not ideal. There are designers, they want to have their things fancy. So you need to have a way to get your fonts. The most popular ones I've seen are Google fonts, and they have a way to say this is how we enter our fonts on our pages. But this is hurting performance because they are embedding a CSS on your page. That CSS you need to download from Google. One DNS lookup, your connection, everything else. Then once you come on this one, it says maybe it's iPhones or whatever amount of phones they are. So you go to a different domain, new SSL connections, new round trips, new everything, and they're downloaded. But on initial connection, there are cases where Google's infrastructure serves in something like 1.5 seconds plus. It's not slow, but it's not fast. It really depends on what is your, let's say, manageable time for all the page loading. In our case, we have requirement to be every under a second, so this was not the case for us, so we couldn't go with that. There are ways to optimize this one further, like inlining CSS for the Google, making fancy complicated stuff, but this is too hard. It requires a lot of server administration, caching problems. So go that if you know what you're doing. The easier way to do it is through this library. It has binaries to pretty much any known front-end framework out there, font-based observer. What it allows is to actually say, show me this default font, but the one that I actually need is in trust. And once it's loaded, just use that. And at that point, you will have some flash sender of text on the board or the website, whatever you're on. So, let's recap. We have this idea of performance budget, and we know how we're spending. So, let's say we have 1 megabyte worth of data for our pages. So, once we go above that, this is what we have. This is also our budget, and we need to optimize. At that point, we need to decide what is this also need the most and optimize that. Because usually, the biggest spender gives the biggest gains for this and so on. Start with the easy thing, so whatever you can fix for half an hour, do that first. It doesn't matter if you can optimize all the other things in 3 months, but if you can do stuff for half an hour and move along, keep the budget low. You're good to go in the team you want. And then it's important for every time to monitor budget planning from day one. Because if you exhaust everything day one and you continue developing for half, 1 year after that, it might be very complicated to actually fix all the issues in that part. Because it might be design related, functionality related, and you can't see all of that time. The last point is optimize only when needed, because if you have the capacity and it's okay for your project to be, that's cool. Because that's the budget. If your budget is how small can my site be, then you might not need to optimize it. So we have any browsers, DevTools, who has used it? No one? No one uses browsers? Okay, one more guys, come on. That's the way. We have Google's PageSpeed. It's a tool where you put a public URL and it analyzes and gives you some hints of what you might need from the website. And then there is browser web page testing. That does essentially what browser DevTools does, but actually records the keys historical data for this one. You have a private installation on it and so on. So hopefully we can have a very fast demo where we can show how we can emulate network details, and I have prepared a page where we can test stuff. So let's go to our page.
that this tool is that it can give you a very fast overview, plus hints and directions of each problem that you might find. I have also positive, like you don't need a tool, but from all our school, very school. That's what this one. Things are more positive, still school. So, yeah, reduce time to first line. Okay. And reduce images. And assets, and cache points. So, there's plenty of stuff to optimize on this page, but still, this is the idea. You send in a page, see what it says, and then one by one, try to optimize. So, I have added these topics, but we essentially don't have much time for session. So, as we have HTTP2, there is an even faster thing in the near future coming to our environment. This is HTTP3. It will resolve all the issues with HTTP2 and essentially be faster, or at least the same fast as the one. And there are different caveats having a couple of notifications. I've recently finished the, let's say, B1 a couple of months back. And it was my huge surprise that a couple of web apps experience 90%+ the overhead of any standard Drupal website that you can make. And then again, they will suffer before, mainly because they're difficult web applications and they are used in quantity of JavaScript they need to go and execute, at least on the initial page. So if you have requirements of a site that needs to be very fast for new users, and there are, say, contractual requirements for having it fast, you might want to reconsider having a couple of that, because it will be very fast once it's in the browser, but actually pushing it there might take time. So, with all of this at hand, we're to the question sections. How do you profile the top structure at the level? Nested this, etc. Well, I use Google DevTools, and if it complains, I start from there. If it doesn't, it's usually okay. Should we decide to use anything to prepare the possible use of Unicorns that is in HTTP3? So, for sendealers, no, this is infrastructure level stuff. If you are responsible for your infrastructure, maybe servers or maybe servers, then yes, you need to do stuff. Is domain sharding still useful? If you're running HTTP 1.1, yes, because you are limited on 6 connections per domain that are concurrent, where in HTTP2 and onwards you have one connection that you can push arbitrary amount of concurrent data through, and having sharding on domain will essentially cause you overhead on DNS lookup level for initial connections. Then it's cached on the browser and it's fast, but initial connections will be essentially slower. What's the next one? Yeah, can you have both size optimized markup for production, but human readable structure source code for local development? Yes. And this is where in Drupal configuration split and stuff like that comes into play, where you can have the software installed and configured on production and development service only, but on your local installation you don't have it, or at least you don't have it labeled, so it doesn't do this work locally. So you can not have all the aggregations on the other things and pieces. Can you respond? Since this image specifies improving the performance, when we have a large number of images for HTTP 1.1. If there are a huge number of images, it's still better. Even if they are small, you actually have them as a separate HTTP request in HTTP 2, maybe, because if you start invalidating them, you can invalidate just one of them on the whole. Essentially, you're spreading traffic. Your server's once people start cache missing this one.
Any surprise for the components?
Yeah. There are no questions on the screen, so if there are any questions from the audience, I'll be very happy to answer them.